that might be a situation where we would use something like this. But other than that, at least in my opinion, we don't really come up too often. Your money gets locked up for a long period of time in most cases. There's some fees involved. Sometimes you already have a pension, or the household already has a pension. So if you've been presented one of these and you want a second opinion, let me know. We should talk about it. Okay, so let's get into retirement planning. Definitely take advantage of these accounts. Definitely the 401k, whatever you can save, the better. It's more money. You might live a lot longer than you realize. You can access it in certain situations, but in the meantime, it'll grow. The 401k plan here, just as Bob was saying, they have options where you can pick your own allocation. They have ones called target date funds where they do all the work for you. You just pick the line item that relates to when you're planning on retiring. They're offering what's called a match, which many employers don't do, so that's good. It's like free money on what you're saving. But retirement goals, so we talk to people all the time about what their goals are, what their plans are in retirement. How to not outlive their money, and then manage the risk of unexpected events, like things that can go wrong during retirement, mostly like health events, really. There used to be this concept that there's a three-legged stool, right? That's retirement planning. You would get a pension, Social Security, and then your money to the extent you saved through like a 401k plan. That's not really working anymore. Pensions are kind of gone. For the most part, they're going away. So a two-legged stool can still work, though, frankly. I work with a lot of people where Social Security, the check that they're scheduled to get, is enough to cover their basic expenses. Social Security is not going anywhere. It's not running out of money anytime soon. It's probably going to change, and we'll talk about that, but Social Security, for the time being, unless they until they make adjustments, and we'll find out what those adjustments are and learn how to interact with them, is going to be a check that you can count on. The reason why I'm reasonably confident that in saying that is we have some history of when they changed Social Security before, and that made it a viable program for decades. They did it back in the 80s, in 1983. They pushed back what's called full retirement age from 65 to 67, right? And this took 37 years to implement. We're actually not even done the change that they made back in 1983. And that doesn't actually really affect you very much. Full retirement age is kind of an irrelevant term. The only thing that full retirement age matters for is you can start to collect your check, and you have the privilege of continuing to work if you wanted to while you're receiving your check. And Social Security won't take any of it back because you went out and worked. That's the only thing that full retirement age is really relevant for. So, and that used to be 65, and then they pushed it back to 67. Now, for most people, if you're still working by that age, for whatever reason, you're probably not starting your Social Security anyway because you're gonna let it grow. You're gonna let it get bigger. And that's what it does if you don't take it and keep working. Now, there are some instances where we have people start their Social Security while they're working, but for the most part, you're just going to wait. But they didn't really change anything else, and that alone, just pushing back to retirement age 2 years, saved a bunch of money and made Social Security a viable program. And it sort of gives us an idea of how they might change it again in the future. They could say, and they might even pass this next year, frankly, they might say that you can't get it as early as 62, you might have to wait until 64, but either way, they're going to phase that in over decades, over time. Yep.
Ryan, is there any benefit to waiting beyond the age of 67 to start collecting?
Yeah,
so does it continue to grow?
Yep, it'll grow all the way until age 70, and it grows pretty substantially for waiting. So as it stands now, anybody here, they haven't changed the rules yet, can start your Social Security anytime between 62 and 70, any month you want in between there. The only thing is, if you start it between 62 and your full retirement age, which is somewhere between 60, it's 66 for most people in here, 62 and 66. If you started in there, you can't really work and make a lot of money. You can't really make more than about $25,000. Otherwise, they're going to start taking back some of your Social Security check. From 66 to 70, if you don't take it and keep working, it's going to grow substantially. It grows 8% a year for every year that you wait. But that doesn't necessarily mean, at least in my opinion, that anybody should plan on working to 66 and then stop and then wait to take your Social Security while you're not working. That's a really tough thing to do, financially and mentally. I mean, you've been working for 50 years and now you're going to stop and you're going to voluntarily not go down to the Social Security office and start collecting a check. So, for the most part, we say, when I'm building like models of people, the rest of people's lives, mostly we just say, wait as long as you can, because it'll go up, and work, you know, as long as you can to save money, but don't have a gap between when you stop working and when you start to take the checks, because what's happening in that time is you're spending your own money. I mean, you're spending something. If it's not Social Security, it's going to be your own money, and we all know how long we're going to live. So might as well get on the payroll if you're going to retire. Yep.
So if someone stops working at 62,
yep,
to collect Social Security, and then they were to go back to work,
can stop it. Yeah.
Okay, you can stop it.
Yep.
But then would you be able to get full retirement at full Social Security at 67?
Yeah, you can restart it again later then. Now they're going to factor in the work that you did, that you went back and did. So you would be all right to do that.
But with the amount, okay, starting versus waiting to 67, if you start and stop at 67, would the amount increase, decrease, stay the same?
It would be higher. Yeah, it would be higher. Okay. Yep. So that's good if you end up. Now, they'll say right on socialsecurity.gov's website, right on the homepage, it says that no matter when you start your Social Security between 62 and 70, you're going to get the same dollar amount over your retirement if you live to your life expectancy. And life expectancy for men is about 82 in a couple months. Life expectancy for females is about 85 in a couple months. So it's kind of a myth that if you're waiting longer, you're going to get more. You're going to get more per month, definitely. You're definitely going to get way more per month from the beginning for waiting. And maybe you have to wait that long to make your Social Security checks big enough to retire with. So then, yeah, we got to wait. But in terms of what you're going to get from the government over your whole retirement, it's actually the same between whether you start at 62 or 70 if you live to your life expectancy. So the question then is, well, do I think I'm going to live past it or not to it? And that might factor into your decision of when to start it as well. But timing when you're going to start it is really, it's difficult, because far more what matters than maximizing what you get from your Social Security is just whether the number is high enough to pay all of your expenses. And the thing about how much that's going to spend, like, is Social Security is taxed unlike anything else in the tax code. Most of your Social Security might not even be taxed at all. There's a formula. It's a kind of a long formula, but they'll do calculations. Either you can do one online or your tax software will do it for you, to figure out how much of your Social Security actually goes on the federal return. If you're doing well and your income is high in retirement, then worst case scenario, 85% of your Social Security goes on the return. That doesn't mean they take back 85% as tax, but that's how much goes on the return. Most people, there is either zero is federally taxable because their income is mostly just the Social Security, which would mean you wouldn't pay any federal tax on it at all, or half of it goes on the federal return. So if you get like $30,000 a year from Social Security between you and a spouse, if there is one, only 15 of it is even going on the federal return, and then, you know, they're doing the formulas, the tax rate, whatever it is, to figure out the tax, which wouldn't be very much. And from a state tax situation, you don't pay state income tax on your Social Security, even here in Maryland. Maryland doesn't charge a tax on your Social Security checks. Most states don't. So if you're planning on moving to another state, they probably don't tax Social Security either. Whatever that state is, if we're talking one-on-one, I can look up whether they do, but they probably don't. Most states don't. So if you have, let's say you work to 65 or so, Social Security is $1,800 a month or something. If you have a spouse and they worked some of the time and their Social Security is $1,200, that's $3,000 a month. That might be what you're getting on a net basis right now, depending on your situation. So it might actually spend like more money than you realize. And if we have faith that the checks aren't going to bounce, they're not just going to do away with the program entirely, that would be not something that I would expect. They'll push back when you can get it long before they just say, you know, let's just do away with Social Security, in my opinion.
I have another question.
Yep.
So we have a population, some of our people work beyond retirement age. Mm-hmm. So the income that they get, plus their Social Security, the income that they get, would they be taxed on that?
From working?
Yes.
Yeah. You're still going to have to pay tax on anything you go out and earn, whether it's before full retirement age or after, definitely, because that's normal earnings. They're going to continue to tax that. But how much you work, how much money you make will factor into how much of your Social Security has to go on your federal return. If you go out and make a lot of money while you're collecting, then worst case, 85% of it will have to go on the return. Not the tax, not the amount of money they're going to pull back from you in tax, just how much goes on the return to figure it out, figure out the tax.
Thanks.
So that's how it works. But 85 would be, you're doing pretty well in retirement, 60, 70,000 a year altogether. From all of your income. Most people is closer to the zero or the 50% range. There's some other things about Social Security to be aware of. There's definitely a disability program that is helpful. It doesn't ever pay anybody enough money really to be comfortable, but it pays something. So if anything were to happen to you where you're disabled, consider that applying, absolutely. Attorneys are available to help with that, or you can apply directly. If there's any situation where you are divorced, your benefit is not going to go down because of that situation or any sort of claiming of benefits that they go due. It just means that they might get a benefit that's based on your working record, your work record over time, but it's not coming out of what you're going to get. And similarly to that, if you're not divorced and you're married, but that person never worked at all, or didn't work much, let's say, they're still going to get a benefit. It's based on your work record, and it's if they start taking it at their age 62, they're going to get 35% of what you're eligible for. So round math, that's $1,000 a month, they would get $350 a month, $2,000 a month, they would get $700. If they wait to their full retirement age to start taking it, they're going to get half of what you're eligible for. So $1,000 would be $500, $2,000 would be $1,000. So your $2,000 plus their $1,000, and that's some good money. Those numbers, it all depends on what your income was. But you can look this up. You can know exactly what your Social Security is going to be within a few dollars by going to socialsecurity.gov. And you set up an account, and it's all free. And now the only thing about this website is that makes an assumption that you keep earning the same amount of money that you're earning now, all the way until the day you collect it, you start collecting, whatever day that's going to be. So if you don't do that, then the number could go down just a little bit. It won't go down a whole lot, but unless there's a real big gap or you stop working for 10 years or something. Okay, so other goals, financial planning, working with somebody like us, what we try to do is number crunch, figure out where you're trying to go. We talk a lot about what's going to happen with the house, honestly, is a pretty regular conversation to try to get retired. Because if somebody has a 401k plan and a Social Security or two Social Securities or maybe even a pension built in, they're probably better off than they realize in terms of an ability to retire. But if we haven't saved a whole lot or we don't have a pension, dealing with the house, making the, where we're living is pretty much the main method, the main way that we go to try to help them retire. Houses in this area, they're more expensive than pretty much anywhere in the country, certainly down the East Coast. Cost of living is cheaper. Maryland's not the greatest state to retire in. Kiplinger just said it's the second worst state for 2019, I guess, to try to retire in. And it's not necessarily the taxes, although they're bad. It's the cost of living. It's the property values and therefore the property taxes on the value. So we have people all day long where they might live in a $300,000 house or $400,000 house around here or something. They go down to South Carolina or Delaware or Florida, they buy pay cash for a house down there, which I would recommend. I wouldn't take a mortgage into retirement. And then they have another $150,000, $200,000 in their pocket, and lower property taxes and lower cost of living. So that's definitely key. And then another thing about the house that doesn't have anything to do with money is like whether there's steps in it. Like you got the big house for the kids, you needed the bedrooms. But now we're getting a little older. The last thing we want to do is be going up and down a whole bunch of steps in retirement. So we might have to move anyway. So if I'm talking to somebody about retirement planning and I got both people in front of me, spouses, like that's one of the first things I'm making sure we talk about. What's the plan for the house? What do we want to do with it? Because sometimes people let that topic, you know, get away from them. And it's important. It's important to make sure you have enough money and you're comfortable from a mobility standpoint. These are some of the things working with a planner does. We talk about taxes and investments. We talk about budgeting, you know, figuring out what your bills are on an annual basis so that we know those are going to continue to be covered in retirement. How's our health? And what's supposed to happen is the person's keeping in touch with you. So if you ever work for somebody in this profession, hopefully they're calling you on at least an annual basis to check in. The budgeting is probably the least fun part of the relationship, but it's something that we got to do because we got to figure out what those core expenses are. Again, if it's enough to where Social Security can cover the basic bills, then you're probably a lot farther along to retirement planning than you might realize. The thing that's difficult about budgeting, though, is there's monthly stuff and then there's one-time stuff. But the one-time stuff seems to happen a lot. It happens on an ongoing basis. So, like, we might say you're going to get $3,000 for Social Security, and that's going to be enough because we gave you this worksheet and you filled it out and it said what your utility bill and your cell phone bill and stuff was, and it only added up to three. But we still have kids, and they're going to come with their hand out every once in a while. We still have a roof, and the roof's going to need to get fixed at some time or another. We want to take a trip every once in a while, and that's kind of a one-time thing. So if we can figure it out where the Social Security, maybe the pension, are covering all the basic stuff because we move south and we sell the house and we downsize and we get frugal, we get, you know, conservative with how we're spending the money, then it might be that everything you're saving into the 401k is for all the one-time stuff, the fun stuff, or at least mostly fun stuff, like travel and anything else you've been wanting to do in retirement. And the thing about that is it's kind of motivational, right? If I agree to save all this money into the 401k because I'm going to spend it on what I want to spend it on in the future, rather than just paying basic bills, I would just rather keep working, might as well. So sometimes it works out like that. Another way to look at it is the first 100 or 200,000 that you save in life, if you can save that much, I really wouldn't count on any of that for regular monthly income. Like the first 100,000 that you save in life into the 401k or otherwise, I would really try to consider setting that aside and not drawing on it even the first day you retire. Just keep it there in case something comes up, because it's going to come up. Everything above the 100,000, that we can start taking a withdrawal from every month while you're retired. And how much you take sort of depends on what age you are when you retire. We typically do about 4% you can take out of it. So if you have $100,000 saved and you take 4% of that, that's about $300 a month. $200,000 would be about $600 a month, and so on. 4% is based on your age, though. Like if you're retiring early 60s, mid-60s, we might start with that. Late 60s, we could probably do like 5 or 6%. things like that. And the reason why we come up with those percentages is there's a lot of research that, says that will allow the money to last as long as you do, basically. So like if we do 4%, you could live for 25 years and the money wouldn't need to earn a dime and you still wouldn't run out of money. It would last 25 years. Which surely it's going to earn something over that time frame, so it'll last longer, but that's the math behind it. This is completely unrelated to retirement, but the emergency fund is sort of that first 100,000 or first 50,000, if you can do it, saving is important, because again, these one-time things that'll come up. While you're working, this is very important if you can do it. The point of this slide, though, while you're working, though, is to say an emergency fund doesn't need to be kept like in a bank account where it doesn't earn anything, at least in my opinion. You can invest that money. It's just people would probably be uncomfortable, and I agree with it, that you've put the emergency fund in the stock market or like some, you know, your brother-in-law's business. That's not really an emergency fund. But it doesn't need to be in the bank either. Like an example of something you probably could put an emergency fund in is like what are called municipal bonds. Municipal bonds is lending money to big utility projects or government, state government, county government, universities, hospitals, things like that. They borrow money all the time. They don't have cash lying around for the most part. They borrow money and they pay you back interest over 30 years or whatever. 2-3%. It's not a whole lot, but it doesn't go up and down a whole lot either. And the nice thing about that is you don't have to pay federal income tax on the interest that they pay you. It's tax-free. Like, you know, you get a bank account, you get a save, you get a tax document at the end of the year, says you earned 12 cents or whatever it is. That 12 cents you got to put on your return and you got to pay taxes on it. This would be a lot more. Without taking a whole lot of risk, a lot up and down. It's not guaranteed. It can go down in value, but without taking a whole lot of risk, and it'll earn more, and it's federally tax-free. And it's liquid. You can get it if you want to, if you need it. So that's another thing. It's not in the slides, but one last thing I'll end on is also with retirement planning is what's called estate planning, so getting legal documents. That's typically, you know, it's been on people's to-do list for like 50 years. but I would say a will, I would probably agree with people that it's all right to be on the to-do list for a little while, because if you don't have minor children anymore, the only real point of a will is to say who's supposed to get your personal items that you want to name.